light of current COVID-19 social distancing guidance, the family, friends, loved ones, and well-wishers of Bishop Lawrence Edward Brown Sr., D.D., have galvanized collectively to honor his life and legacy in virtual memoriam of an apostolic general in Christendom and father in the faith to many, who has lain down his sword upon elevation to glory. We pray that the life of Bishop Lawrence Edward Brown Sr. will inspire and fuel your life's charge in that he fought a good fight, finished his course, and kept the faith. What you will see in this virtual memorial documentary, a movie of sorts, is a trip down memory lane through songs, inspiring stories, poetic expressions, humor, and heartfelt tributes that weave the tapestry to an amazing legacy and tree of righteousness that serves as a template and a model for fathers, families, pastors, bishops, leaders, and up-and-comers for generations to come. As our victory over COVID-19 affects, the family and loved ones of Bishop Lawrence E. Brown Sr. deliberately chose not to exclude any of the tremendous content excitedly contributed by many to honor the life of this apostolic giant, but to allow time for these expressions that will water your soul. So come along as you'll laugh, you'll cry, and praise God as we celebrate the life and legacy of this kingdom prince. Here's to 84 years strong. Be blessed by the journey.
Your announcer for this morning has been Sister Mary McCall. The next voice you will hear will be that of our pastor and your friend, District Elder Lawrence E. Brown Sr. He'll lead us to the throne of grace and go as the Lord leads. Will the congregation please stand?
Thank you very much, Sister McCoy. And greeting to those of you in our radio audience and also you in the auditorium. Once again, we come tell you that Jesus Christ is a true lover of your soul. Now I want you to draw your minds in, trust the Lord with all of your heart, and lean not to your own understanding. Oh Lord Jesus, our Father God today, we thank you for the wonderful power that's in your name to heal all manner of disease and sickness. You're mighty to save, mighty to heal, mighty to make the ways of your people. Lord God, it is of your mercies that we're not consumed. Because your compassion fail not, they renewed again every morning, and great is thy faithfulness. We pray, Lord God, that you would touch those who have made requests, heal those who are sick, save those who are lost, and oh Lord, we'll praise you. We'll thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank God. Amen and amen.
Thessalonians chapter 4 verses 16 through 18. For the Lord himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and with the trump of God, and the dead in Christ shall rise first. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. Wherefore, comfort one another with these words. May the Lord add a blessing to the hearers and doers of his word.
Lawrence Edward Brown was born on December 22, 1935 in Indianapolis, Indiana, and lived at the corner of 20th and Edgewood Streets. He was the fifth of eight children: Earlene, Marion, Cleveland, Norma, Lawrence, Marva, Beverly, and Alta, born to Mr. Cleveland and Mrs. Josie Brown. The Browns relocated from Indianapolis to St. Louis, Missouri in 1940, when little Lawrence was merely 5 years old. At the tender age of five, the eldest sister, Earlene, sent Lawrence on a train by himself to St. Louis from Indianapolis to accompany his parents. Hence, Lawrence, who was not much older than a toddler, would begin a life of travel and movement that would span nearly 84 years. As a teenager, Lawrence was athletic. He boxed in the Golden Gloves and played football for Sumner High School in the position of running back. Lawrence also began exhibiting leadership at an early age in that he marched alongside Dick Gregory to advocate for a larger facility for his high school due to overcrowding. The demonstration proved effective in that a new facility was granted to the school and Lawrence appeared on the front page of the St. Louis newspaper in the early 1950s as a result of the march. Lawrence later graduated from Sumner High School.
I have always been an active young man, even as a child, when the schools were segregated and they didn't have one black high school. I marched to the Board of Education with Dick Gregory and also Grace Brumry, and the school gave us a new school called Bates Sumner Branch. And that has been something I've enjoyed in life, is to help black folk move up from where they are. Charles Sumner High School is the oldest black school in St. Louis, Missouri. And it is still standing as a beacon for those who want to go to him. There have been many of black celebrities that have come out of that school, such as Grace Brumry, Arthur Ashby, and also the Brumry Boys.
This is Dr. Norma McCoy, along with my husband, Bishop A. John McCoy. And we just wanted to give this tribute to my brother, my dear brother, Bishop Lawrence E. Brown, Sr., whom we love dearly. He was a close friend of mine, not only my natural brother, a brother in the natural, but a friend of my husband and I. We certainly have been friends, and we fellowship with each other in the ministry for the last, long as he's pastored, Bishop pastored 50 years, and Bishop Brown for the last 36 years. We fellowship with each other. We've attended conventions together. We've attended leadership conferences together. And we've just been in each other's company. And I'm going to certainly miss him dearly. We're going to miss him. Amen. All the conversation we had about the Lord, about the church and church issues, I'm going to miss my brother so much. But I want to say to his 8 children, your children, you have our prayers and our sympathy. Amen. You have good memory of your dad. I thank God for your father. Thank God for his wife, Lady Dorothy Brown. We just thank God for the family. We've certainly been praying for you all. God is with you. We have wonderful memories of my brother. Amen. Good memories. I just thank God for giving him 84 years of life. I praise the Lord. He was at my last 85th birthday party dinner. My brother was there. I think that's the last time I saw him at the council. But we really fellowship beautiful at my 85th birthday. And I'm going to miss my brother because he came to everything we had. It was at my husband's 85th, 86th birthday. So we've just been good friends as well as brothers and sisters over the last many, many years. So I thank God for his life. I thank God for his ministry. I just said, children, be encouraged. Amen. Your father has fought a good fight. He kept the faith and finished his course.
Yes.
He's gone now, henceforth now, he's gone to receive a crown of righteousness, whom the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give him in that day, not to him only, but to all of us also who love his appearing. God bless you and God keep you is our prayers in the name of the Lord. Amen.
We thank God for those lovely remarks coming from Dr. McCoy. And we thank God for this family.
Yes.
We want them to know that we are praying for them.
Amen, amen.
God is able to comfort you at this particular time.
Yes, he
is. I want to say I thank God for 64 years, hallelujah, that we had fellowship with Bishop Lawrence Brown Sr. We thank God for the beautiful fellowship that we had.
Yes.
We've visited each other's church.
Yes.
Be able to encourage each one. We discussed problems together. We were able to come to some conclusion. And we just thank God for how he has been a great friend.
Yes.
Amen. I'm reminded of how David felt when he heard Jonathan had passed. And David and Jonathan was very close.
Yes.
And then Bishop Lawrence Brown Sr. and I was very close.
Yes, yes.
And I want to say God bless each and every one, and to his lovely wife, a man who has stuck by his side, had done a beautiful job in taking care of him, amen. And we want her to know that we are praying for Dorothy Brown, that
God will
give her strength.
Yes.
Amen. In the hour of her bereavement.
That's correct.
And we just thank God for her coming into his life and made his last 10 years a happy 10 years his life. So praise the Lord and God bless you.
Thank God. My brother has translated from the dying to the living.
Hallelujah.
Praise God. He's gone from life to eternal life. And we're going to see him again one day. So children, have this hope. Live right so we can see Dad again throughout eternity. Spend eternity with him. God bless you all in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Greetings to the family of the late, great Bishop Lawrence E. Brown. To his wife, his children, and grandchildren. You truly had a great father and husband. He loved you dearly, and he was a great man of power, of strength, and of faith and mercy, and the grace of God just exhumed through him. He cared so much about people. I can remember as his sister, he and I being very, very close and doing many, many things together, because as a child, my mother would tell him to look out for me. He was my big brother. And so we grew up being close and doing many things together, such as we worked on the same job for 20 plus years, where I saw Bishop Brown and the grace of God on him and the power of God on him. He was so concerned about the employees that many, many of them were saved and filled with the Holy Ghost because of his ministry to them, even on the job. That was both male and female. Also, my brother and I lived together in the same apartment. We had separate apartments, but his family and my family lived in an apartment that we wanted to use for so long. It was very hard in those days because they did not feel like children should have really nice places to live. So many times they would offer you substandard housing. But Pastor Lawrence Brown and I looked at an apartment, and they told him that he would not be able to get it because of his children. Now, I'm there with him. But he said, Marvin, we're going to go home and pray, and we're going to fast, and we're going to believe God, because he was a man of faith, as I said. We went home, and we fasted, and we prayed. And not only did he get the apartment, but my family and I also got an apartment. So both of us lived in that apartment together. We enjoyed so many wonderful times together. My husband and Lawrence were such good friends. They would exchange clothes, they exchanged money, they exchanged cars. If one's car wasn't running, the other one would use that car. Lawrence was a caring, kind person, and they just got along wonderful. We loved him as a young man. Also, Pastor Brown has just loved people all of his life and always been concerned from a child up. He was very kind and always trying to keep people from getting beat up or wounded or being bullied as children would do, because he cared so much and he was so merciful toward people. I can remember as the Lord began to work with him and call him into ministry while he was pastoring as assistant pastor at Bethesda Temple Church. He let me know how much God was dealing with him about becoming a pastor himself. And he thought, well, Marva, I don't know how I'm going to do it, because sometimes it was a struggle just taking care of his family and keeping a roof over their heads. But God was beginning to deal with him now about having taking care of and putting together the house of God and being over the house of God. I remember how he said he didn't know if he could do it, but he was going to pray, and we began to pray about this. Again, he exercised his faith, because this was a great man of faith. And as we prayed during that time, God was using him greatly at Bethesda. But one of the members saw him, a person that came to visit the church, saw how enthusiastic and how anointed he was. And she made the statement that she was looking for a pastor. He knew that God had called him to pastor, but didn't have the money. He said, I don't have the money to rent a building or buy a building. But this woman, who was a woman of great means, came along and said, not only will you rent this building, but we will purchase you a building. And that's what she did. And not only did she purchase my brother a building, but she purchased him a brand new Cadillac. I mean, these were miracles, and these were things that happened in my brother's life. So today you've got a great legacy from your father, and please carry it on, children. Keep going, take the torch, and keep running with it, because you've got a father who was able to do great things, and I know you're going to do great things also. God bless you today.
My name is Bishop Lawrence Brown, Sr. I am the father of 8 children and am minister of the gospel for 65 years, and also have been pastoring for 35 years. I was assistant pastor of Bethesda Temple of the Apostolic Faith in St. Louis, Missouri for 20 years. And I'm enjoying this wonderful journey I'm on. I thank God for the wonderful family I have. 8 children, 6 of them are in the ministry, and they are preaching machines. The McMunns lived right across the street from the Browns in the 4200 block on East Garfield. And I met a dear little lady, and we courted for a number of years, and I was married to the love of my life, Sister Kate T. Brown. And out of that marriage, I have 8 children. And most of them are godly children. They're children that love the Lord, and they're somewhere in the ministry. Now, after some years, after my dear wife of 54 years had passed away, God sent me another woman in the person of Evangelist Dorothy Book. My children are always in excess to me. I love them very much, and I try to teach them the way of the Lord. And I found out the teaching that I've given them has ended up being a blessing to them and to me. For where I was blessing them, now they've come back to bless me. Amen.
Meet the real Browns. In 1954, Lawrence married Kate Treen McMullen, his childhood sweetheart, with whom he celebrated 54 years of marriage. Together, they birthed 10 children: Catherine, Elaine, Mary, Lawrence Jr., Vanessa, Ruth, Edward, Philip, Sherry, and Marcia, 8 of whom are alive and active today. Elaine and Edward passed away as infants and at childbirth. From these 8 children, Lawrence Edward Brown Sr. has become the patriarch of 5 generations and 102 offspring produced from his loins. Not only does he have Lawrence Jr. as his first namesake, but God also granted him Lawrence Edward Brown III to continue his name to further generations. Over time, Daddy Brown, as he was affectionately called, also gained 2 daughters-in-law, Tanya Brown, the wife of Lawrence Jr., and Tenia Brown, the wife of Philip.
And so they said, talk about Daddy as a father, as a child growing up. When you stop and think about him, there's so many things that come to your mind. So many things. And we do know that it's already been said that you're a great provider, one that loves family. And I got this shirt on that says love. If I had to say it all in one word, that would be the word
for it. Right.
Mm-hmm. I know that Dad has been raised in a family where there were also eight children in his family, his mother and father. They had eight children in the household. Mm-hmm. And strong leadership in that household and a lot of love. And when he being raised in a household with Daddy, lots of love, strong leadership. You wouldn't have known that we weren't rich by just looking at the way we behaved, because we didn't know that. I guess we were classified as being poor. I still don't know that today, because there was so much love in the house and the resources that we had were well managed. They were well managed, and there was prayer in the household. And God had a way of making things stretch like no other. I remember we had, at one time, there was a turkey at the house. Turkey was a little bitty turkey. I didn't know a turkey could be little. But it looked like a little chicken, but Mom, Dad, they said it was a turkey. I was like, that's not a turkey. That's a little. It's just a turkey that's been on a diet or something. It was little in the roast pan. It just had a lot of room around it. And we were all saying, that's not going to be enough for all these people. They prayed over that turkey. Seasoned it, put it in the oven. That thing, it was as if the thing had grew in the oven. It was too tight to fit in the roast pan. Mm. Prayer makes a difference. So they prayed over, they would pray over their money, pray over everything. The thing that I could say about Dad is so many things that you can say over and over and over again about him being a good person. He's the type of father that you want to be around. You have children nowadays, they run from their dads because they're afraid of him. Some of them don't know their dads and some of them are afraid of him. We're not afraid about that. We even knew the sound of the motor in his car when he would be driving up. We did not. We could be down in the basement, and we knew the sounds of the different cars, but we knew the sound of the motor of his car, and we knew when he was coming home because it had a certain sound to it. And we come running about that basement, running to that front door. Before you could get there, you got two on each arm, a couple on the leg, one, and then two more probably fighting because they didn't get on our leg just to hang on, that while he's dragging us through the house. And we're glad that he was home. So, when you talk about values, you talk about values. I think some of the things that I value the most is not only the teaching, because we can teach a whole lot of things, but being an example of what should be as a parent. He's loving, patient, can give you a multitude of advice in one sentence, can give you a love without saying words, but his actions spoke volumes. One of his favorite sayings was one of them, it'll get better. When things weren't quite what we thought they should be, you say, it'll get better, it'll get better. And then we say, well, this is not, we need a new this, that, and the well, this will do for now. That was another one.
Yep.
He's a good-hearted person, but there's another statement that stuck with me also. He would say things like, consistency is a jewel.
Right.
Consistency is a jewel, and right. I've learned to put those sayings in my heart, put them in action. Like my other sister said, you can stay on a job if you have take hold of some of the wise sayings. Consistency is a jewel. When you feel like you want to give up on some of these jobs you go out to, there's so much going on, especially I work in the public school system. With all the shootings and the violence and the different things, sometimes I have to remember consistency is a jewel.
Right.
And not only that, prayer works. I've seen the Lord raise him up off of a sick bed, do many, many miracles through the hand and the working of him. So I can go into the system and I don't worry about somebody coming in shooting up the school, although we have been on lockdown a few times because there were active shooters in the area. These are things that they don't tell you. But then I revert back to the miracle working hand is God doesn't have a boundary as far as where he works. And that comes from the upbringing of this man's teaching, and not just teaching it, but living it. I thank the Lord and I'm happy for the fact that we learned that our parents are human. Even though he's just a man, I love the fact that even when there were difficulties, he kept moving, stayed steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the things and the work of the Lord. He's always been consistent in what he does, been consistent, and his greatest consistency has been toward God. He's been consistent with the Lord. He's been consistent because there are days when I felt that I couldn't make it, and I'm like, this, I love the Lord, but this I can't do. Mm-hmm. I'm sure he had days like that also.
Yeah.
But he hung in there. Sometimes when people agreed with him, sometimes when people didn't agree with him, sometimes when people didn't understand him, sometimes when I didn't understand. One thing about it, he would always pop up and strive to stay in the will of God. He has a great love for people. Great love for people. And when I go to the council in different services, when they find out, oh, you Bishop Brown's daughter, the one thing that some of the saints have said, and I really, really treasure that, this one lady said, she said, you know, there's one thing about your father, he will take time to speak to everybody. Sometimes you'd be like, come on, we're ready to go. He will take time to speak to everyone. They say everybody, it's not just the bishop that he'll talk to. He'll talk to anybody that's speaking to him, or that he sees he's going to speak to everybody. And people appreciate that, because none of us should get so high to the point where we forget. All of us are flesh and blood, and we're just passing through. But I do have a lot of people that admire him, and I admire him, and I love him. And I say, if I had to give him a nickname, there was a song that goes through my mind. You're my hero.
All right.
You are my hero.
All right.
Because I love the fact that I've seen you in the rough, on the mountain, and in the valley, in places in between, but you've been consistent. You have a true heart. You're not only a man of God, but you're a good person, you're a good father, and God has given you a good heart toward people. And the love that you project makes a difference in this world. You've made a difference in this world, and you will continue to make a difference, because you're doing it right now.
All right.
Hello, my name is Philip Brown. I am the third youngest of Lawrence and Kate Brown's children. What I remember as a child growing up in the Brown household with my father is he was a very kind man, very kind. He was someone that would always be kind when we would go to the park and do certain things together. And he was just a kind man. I can remember when he went to work as a child, he would gather bottles together. The bottles, they would be large, medium, and small. You get a nickel, a dime, and a quarter off, depending on the size. He also, to make money as a child, that's what he would bring me home, bottles from the Nixdorf Chain Company. And sometimes he would bring us sandwiches from his lunch. Sausage, egg, and cheese sandwiches that he had from his lunch. And I enjoyed those things when he brought those home. And then also, when I did my chores, he would award me by giving me a box of bottles. And when we went to Nationals at the time, the store was Nationals, we went to cash in the bottles, and I would get $7, $8, $9, $10 off those bottles. Back then, in the early 70s, that was a lot of money for a child my age. So I was very grateful for that. Also around Christmas time, I remember he would bring those boxes of food on with the different color decorations in them. And we just had a great time as a child growing up. Also in our community, everybody wanted to be around the Browns' house. Everybody wanted to be around the Browns because they were kind. We had fun, you know. But we had my mother, she was no nonsense. If you didn't act right, she would straighten you out. So when they saw my mom coming sometimes, they would say, here come Mother Brown, here come Miss Brown, Miss Brown. They would run. They had two different personalities. But when they see my dad come sometimes, they would just relax and say, Mr. Brown is coming, Mr. Brown is coming. So those were things that I remembered as a child. Also, my father, he encouraged me to play sports. I was able to relate with him in baseball and sports. We would talk about baseball. He would, teach me about baseball and some of the fundamentals of baseball. So that's where I started playing Little League Baseball. I played for all the way up to high school. I played baseball as a child. And I enjoyed those things. I really enjoyed those things. And another thing I enjoyed about, I remember as a child, he was a godly man. He was a preacher. He was assistant pastor of Bethesda Temple Church. And as a family, he took us to church. He didn't just send us, but he took us to church. I remember on Sundays, the car would be piled up with all of us in there, 7 or 8 children, and my mother. We would go to the church. It was on Del Mar and Clara at that time. And we would pile up and go to that church, and we would have a good time. And he trained us up in the way of holiness and godliness. And we would come home and have a good Sunday meal and everything. It was just a wonderful time back when I was growing up. Now, the days that he was off, I remember him very clearly, Wednesdays and Thursdays. He was off on Wednesdays and Thursdays, and we would all be waiting for him to come home from the first job because he spent the rest of the evening with his family on Wednesday evenings or Thursday evenings, and he taught Bible study on Wednesdays at Bethesda Temple Church. But I remember that it was a very good time in my life. And as I went on to be a young man, he trained me up as the way that I should go. But when I got older, I went on my own, and maybe 17, 18 years old, I went and left the house. But the Word of God was still on the inside of me. He trained me up in the way that I should go. So I went on with life and started doing my own thing and everything. And then the Lord saved me in the year of 1989. And then in about the year 1995, the Lord called me to the ministry after I was saved. And he became my pastor at the Pentecostal Church of Jesus Christ. He taught me all the things, the ins and outs of the Word of God. He taught me how to move in and out amongst the saints, and he taught me how to do every aspect of the church. He taught me those things. He preached the Word of God to me. And those words that he preached to me and preached to all of us, they stick with me even now. Sometimes we eat dinner sometimes, and I can bring up a sermon that he preached years and years ago, or there might be a situation that he taught me in church, and that would come back up to me, and I can recall those things, and I would tell him, remember when you taught me this, and remember when you taught me that. And the same way with my sons. They learn the same things. My sons learn the same things that I learned under my father. And I'm just so grateful. I'm grateful to have had and still have a father that of his caliber and his magnitude. A man full of wisdom, knowledge, and an encouraging man. And then the Lord has called me to the ministry, and he taught me all those things pertaining to ministry. And I'm just very, very grateful to have a father such as him. And I can say, Daddy, I love you, and keep on doing what you're doing in Jesus' name. God bless you.
This is my father, Bishop Lauren Z. Brown, Sr. My father was, in my mind, my best friend when I was a little kid. I would watch him and follow him and follow him and watch him. I just loved him, and he made me feel like I was the only kid. He probably did that to everybody. It was like I was the only kid, but it was 8 of us.
Right.
And he was very good to me, spoiled me to the point where I kind of got spoiled one day. I shouldn't have did that. That didn't work out too well. But I love my father. He loves me. He has taught me so many things. Things that I wouldn't have learned. You know, people say sometimes, oh, it doesn't matter if your father's there, you still, well, God is good, whether your father's there or not. But it was an amazing blessing to grow up with a father who, like I said, introduced me to Jesus Christ.
All right.
Whom I still love today, and my father still loves Jesus Christ today. He didn't introduce me and then drop off himself. He introduced me and he stayed with the Lord. He preaches, and his sermons, I remember a sermon he preached called So Many Voices in the City. I remember that today. Just so many voices in the city. And listen to the Lord. Don't listen to all the voices in the city. I thank him for being a provider. I thank him for being kind to me. People don't have to be kind to you, even though they're your relatives.
Right.
For him being kind to me. I thank him for being loving and funny. I thank him for doing the things that he did as little children that I would never forget. Like I said, fixing that back, making that back porch, doing things, taking us for rides. He would take us, every time he got paid, he would take us, we go get a Whopper burger. Mm-hmm. Everybody can get their own Whopper burger. And I remember one time he took us to, there was a store called Veterans Village.
Yeah.
And normally when we went to the store, it was like, can we get this, can we get that? Because it was eight of us, you know, we couldn't get everything in the new store. But he took us to Veteran Village one time. We was like, can we get this, get that? He said, oh, yeah, I can splurge in here. Go ahead, get whatever you want.
Yeah.
So we racked up. He was an awesome provider. Just thank him for being in my life. You know, I just thank God for my father. He's not just a bishop. That's one of the titles, but he was my dad first. And I love him for who he is and what he has done in our whole family's life. The grandkids, the great-grands, he just loved family. And we love him. Wherever there's family, they say, you can find love.
Mm-hmm.
And wherever there's my dad, you can find love.
All right.
You can get this on camera.
Thank you.
I love my dad.
Thank you very much.
My father, he was not only a father to me, but being a single parent, he was a father to my children. But I had children young, and he was a father, you know, to them as well. He never turned them away or anything like that. He was a great father. He was a supplier to my children as well as to me. He taught us a lot of things about life, just common sense things that not so common today, you know, that you couldn't live without. He was a great provider for me and my children. My father was very thoughtful. He is very thoughtful. He's still here. Very thoughtful man. Never left anybody out. I remember we were little children when we moved on to Edison, if I may say. We were still going to school in the city, because we moved on Edison in April. My father made sure he set up a ride for us through his father that we would continue to keep going to the school that we were going to keep that continuity. So he's a man that likes to keep things in balance and stable, and where, you know, you'll kind of know where things are. They bought a house back in a time when I don't think a lot of black people had houses, because we were the first black people on the block. And so that's him trying to provide. And in that, he is in his working and being stable in those areas. In my adult life, it caused me to be stable. Going to my job, I kept one job for like 30 years, you know. That work ethic, that church ethic, the best thing my dad ever gave me was Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ. He introduced me to Jesus Christ, whom I love today because of my father.
My advice to my children is to keep on doing the right that they know, keep walking with God the way they know it, and strive to be stronger in the Lord and in the power of His might. Don't give no space for the devil. And I say to them, love one another. Let there be no dissension among yourselves. Love each other as Christ has loved the church. And if you do that, you will satisfy your Father on earth and also your Father in heaven. In my young days, it was a pretty hard time being the father of 8 children. And so God put it in my heart to get an extra job. And so I decided I wanted to buy me a new car. So I decided to work on a job for 1 year. But the job was so easy and so down to earth, I took the job and worked 16 years on 2 jobs. And when I became a pastor, I put the job down and went into full passion. As a young minister, I had some great experience in life, and sometime my health became a challenge to me. When I first became assistant pastor of Bethesda Temple, I got a condition that was called rheumatic fever, where I wasn't able to walk for 6 months, and I would have night sweats and wake up in the middle of the night and change my pajamas. And one day, my mother and my aunt were home, and I told them I was so sick I needed to get in the bed. When they put me in the bed, the Lord spoke to me and said, get out that bed and walk. I got out the bed, was dragging through the house. Power of God hit me in the top of my head, and I ran through the house and went to the council in Alton, Illinois. I've been running for Jesus for a long time, and I'm not tired yet. There came another incident, and these incidents were really great for church activity. When we purchased our church on Dr. King Drive, we purchased an insurance policy on a Friday. The church burned down on a Monday, and the church paid us 4 times what the insurance policy asked for. So after that, everything that I intended for the church to be in 8 years, it was done in 8 months. Another time down on Dr. King Drive, I bought me a Cadillac, a modern day Cadillac, and somebody stole my Cadillac. And we came out of the church, we prayed, Lord, please send the pastor's car back. Please send it back. When I got home, my car was parked in my driveway. What had happened was that the people who stole my car, my son saw them driving down Lucas and Hunt and Highway 70, said, that's my father's car, and got the police, and they followed them on Edison Avenue and parked my car right in the driveway. That was another miraculous thing. So those are some of the miraculous things that happened in my life, and I do appreciate them. Amen.
Should I seek him? And the word says, seek him until he reigns righteousness over the church of the living God. So today, we want and walk with God and hold fast to those things that we've heard. The Bible says, hold on to those things you heard. How much you let them slip? We've got to find a way to hold on to the things that God has told us in past years. And what God has said to us, the Bible says Jesus is the same today, yesterday, and forevermore. So if he was called for holiness and righteousness and evangelizing 2,000 years ago.
My first indication that I was called to the ministry was, first of all, I had a strong and love for the Word of God, and I always wanted to see people saved. My father was a preacher, and I followed him around everywhere, and he preached, and he gave me a chance to preach, and that's where I began my real preaching thing. I became a member of Bethesda Temple Church. I was the chairman of the young people. I taught the minister's class, and after that, I was promoted to the assistant pastor Bethesda Temple and also the vice chairman of the board of directors. After becoming a minister at the Church of God, I was elevated to the teachers of the young people. And I was the chairman of the young people. First, I was vice chairman of the young people under the chairman. And after a few years, I was made the chairman of the young people of Bethesda Temple. I was made the vice chairman of the board of directors at Bethesda Temple. And I was assistant pastor for 20 years under the Honorable Bishop James A. Johnson. During that time, there were some things that were done, and they were looking for somebody to teach a class at Forest Park Community Choir. And I was called on by one of the doctors that was there, who called on me and asked would I take that position. I taught at the Forest Park Community Choir for 2 years, and then their class got so big, they got where they wanted us to pay, and we didn't have the money. I'm Bishop Lawrence Brown, and I am the pastor of the Pentecostal Church of Jesus Christ, and have been pastor of the Pentecostal Church of Jesus Christ for 35 years. I have been preaching for 65 years. I was the assistant pastor of Bethesda Temple Church of the Apostolic Faith for 20 years under the leadership of Bishop James A. Johnson. After so many encounters with the Word of God and teaching the Word of God and telling people about Jesus, the Lord inspired me to take the helm of the gospel and preach the gospel. I let my pastor know that I've been called to the ministry. He said, well, I could tell that you had something special on you because your testimonies were nothing but sermons. And so when I got through talking to him, and there were a number of older ministers there. In fact, I was the youngest minister there. And Bishop Johnson made me an assistant pastor. And I said to him, I don't know whether I'd be able to take this because I'm too young. He said, God will help me. And I got that position and served in that position for 20 years and 3 months.
Praise the Lord to the entire Brown family, to Lady Dorothy Brown, the entire Pentecostal Church of Jesus Christ Church family, to the Brown children. There are 8 of you. I don't want to start calling names because I fear I may leave someone out, to the extended family and to all of the friends. I want to send my condolences to all of you on behalf of the Bethesda Temple Church of the Apostolic Faith Incorporated, which, of course, we all know was Bishop Brown's home church under the tutelage of the late Honorable Bishop James A. Johnson, who was a father in the gospel to many of us. I know these are very trying times And we have people who are passing off the scene right now for a number of reasons. Many people's hearts are sad. And the reason their hearts are sad is because they don't know the hope that we have. We have something we can hold on to that serves as an anchor for our soul at moments like this. And the beautiful thing that makes the difference in the types of settings that you all are in right now is the power of the Holy Ghost. And we thank God for Bishop Brown and the life that he lived. He was a very kind man, always had a kind word to say, loved to talk, loved to hold conversation. And I'm going to miss his face at our councils and our MDC related events. But we know that he's resting with the Lord in paradise, where he's no longer suffering, no longer has to deal with the ailments of his physical body. And God has given him a body of righteousness where he can enjoy the presence of the Lord forevermore. And soon and very soon, and the signs are around us, we're going to be joining him, because the Lord is soon to come. And we're going to be, if we're alive and remain, as the scriptures say, caught up together with him and a host of other saints who have gone on before, to meet them in the cloud along with the Lord in the air. And so shall we ever be with the Lord. I know there aren't words that I could say that can take away the pain. For me, he was bishop, but for many of you, he was husband, he was granddaddy, he was dad, so many other terms of endearment. And there's nothing that we can do to really take the pain away, but we can point you to the one who does have the power to console your heart at a moment like this. And you know, of course, it's our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. I want you to know that the entire Bethesda Temple Church family, myself, along with Lady Melanie Johnson, all of us here at Bethesda, we're going to be praying for you all, that God comfort you and give you the strength that you need to be able to endure in this season of sorrow and yet joy at the same time. God bless you all is our prayer in Jesus' name.
Greetings in the matchless name of Jesus. I am Lady Dursley Middleton, and I'm here with my pastor and husband, Pastor Joe Lewis Middleton. We are from the City of Life Christian Church in University City, Missouri. And we'd like to leave a tribute for the Honorable Bishop Lawrence Brown. He was a friend of Pastor Middleton's and myself. I met Bishop Brown at the time, Elder Brown, over 45 years ago at Bethesda Temple Church, where Bishop Johnson was, Elder Johnson at the time, we were at Delmar and Clara. So it was about 40, 45 years ago. And from that time till the last time I saw him, a year or so ago, there was one constant theme that I always remembered about Bishop Brown, and that's his winning personality. I would say he had the spirit of Christian hospitality. Whenever you saw him, whether you saw him at a mall or you saw him at church or wherever you saw him, he had this beautiful, radiant, winning smile. And he always had time to spend with the people of God. I will always remember that. And that has endeared me to him all of his life, because whenever you'd see him, he would have something good to say to you, and usually left you with a smile. He always had a nice joke or something to tell you. And that's one of my treasured memories of Bishop Lawrence Brown. Pastor Middleton.
This tribute is given to celebrate the life of Bishop Lawrence Brown Sr. I met Bishop Lawrence Brown Sr. in the late 80s, and one of the telling trademarks of that relationship, having known him, is his pleasant, Christ-like, loving personality. Mm-hmm. He was such an encourager. He loved the things of God. He loved the ways of the Lord. He loved talking about Jesus. He loved celebrating Jesus. His life, his legacy, has spread beyond himself to his family, his children, getting to know his children and interfacing and relating with them has been just as wonderful. I would say the legacy of Bishop Brown, I am in my mind recalls the words of Henry Wadsworth Longfellow in A Psalms of Life. He retails or details in his Psalms of Life about the life of a great man. He said, lives of great men all remind us we can make live our lives sublime, and departing leave behind us footprints on the sands of time. Footprints that perhaps another traveling o'er life's solemn main, a forlorn and shipwrecked brother, seeing shall take heart again. That's the legacy that Bishop Lawrence Brown Sr. leaves for all who touched his life, a legacy that inspires and encourages them to do the work of the Lord and finish strong. God bless you, family, in Jesus' name.
I am a friend of Bishop Lawrence Brown Sr. He is one of the kindest men I have ever known. My mind goes back to when his first wife, who is now deceased, died. And we went to the home and we took the children away, you know, and he hugged and kissed. I said, we're not gonna keep them. We'll bring them all back. He was so loving and so kind. He had a spell of illness, and I'm in the medical field, and I knew the illness that he had would lead some permanent damage. So when he started back preaching, I used to sit and kind of, you know, be praying for him, because I'm saying, medically, he's supposed to not do this. And I guess today he'll find out how many times I prayed for him and how he defied science. What was supposed to happen to him never happened. The day that God told him to pick up his bed and walk, God completely healed him.
My name is Ella Walter Cole. My title is assistant pastor. Well, we don't really go by numbers now, but in the past, I was assistant pastor number two, and Elder Brown was assistant pastor number one. But I just like to give, in my own way, that how that the Browns, we go way back. And I asked Elder Brown what was his age. He told me he's 82 and I'm 83. I've been married come July the 5th for 63 years. Yeah, so I just thank God for how that a story go with the Browns. When I was under the spell of the devil in the Ville, we all came up in the Ville. And at Sumner High School, I was in public speaking with Sister Norma McCoy and one of the Mac Miller, I think her name is Mary Allen. But we was in public school, I mean public speaking together. Little did I know that I would be saved one day, but Jesus broke the spell of the devil and I'm saved. And I met my wife in Sumner High School. And from then on, I thank God for her, through her and her family, I'm saved today. I would like to add that her uncle, Elder Jesse Adams, was the first candidate that was baptized on the Bishop Johnson ministry. And if you would look at the legacy, how we came into holiness, it was through him. Many of our family members are saved, got power position in holiness, and we are here today. My sons, my grandkids, but been baptized in Jesus' name and filled with the precious gift of the Holy Ghost. And I just thank God for that. But I go back to Bishop Brown, and how on Delmar, me and Bishop Brown was Sunday school teachers together. And from then on, after he left, I carried on. And then I became a Sunday school teacher with Bishop James A. Johnson. Then I carried his class on. But today, I'm just happy. I didn't know all of this was going to be taking place. And but I just thank God for how the family, how that I remember when I was in the tent ministry, and how the Sister Dorothy Stephen was one of my musicians. And we traveled all around in Missouri and Illinois, preaching and teaching the gospel. But I just thank God for this opportunity to be able to be saved for such a time as this. We'll never know that how God is going to use us and what is ahead for us. So I just thank God today for being in being chosen. I didn't know I was going to do this, but but I just thank God anyhow. Be prepared, you know. Amen.
One of the things that was always told to me, you ought to have your own church. You're preaching as good as anybody around here, and you should not be letting your work be served under another ministry. It's time for you to leave and start your own work. That did not faze me, because I knew in order for you to start a church, God would have to tell you to do that. So when the Lord spoke to me, I did not know which way to go. I didn't have a building. I didn't have no money, but there was a bishop named Bishop Walter McMichael who was looking for a pastor of a church called Pentecost Power. And he asked me, would you take that church as pastor? And I prayed on it and decided I would take the church as pastor. And he bought me a church, $32,000 cash. And when I started that church, I started it up with about 20 members. And the rest is history about the beginning. But I say to any minister who is intending to serve God in the pastor capacity to make sure that God tells you and not other folk.
me in my mind. That's something I praise the Lord, that God will loose the band. That's something I praise the Lord, that God will open the door.
It's to our God. Y'all know how we do it. Take it up and praise. It's to our God. Every word of worship. With one accord. Come on, say every praise. Every praise. It's to our God.
Praise the Lord. This is Bishop Sylvester Burris, pastor of the New Beginnings Apostolic Church, Portageville, Missouri, as well as the Greater Grace Apostolic Church, Dyersburg, Tennessee. I want to take this opportunity to offer our sincere condolences on behalf of Mother Burris and myself and the entire Burris family, as well as the church family, to the Brown family and the loss of our dear friend, Bishop Lawrence E. Brown, Sr. Amen. Certainly, amen. Bishop Brown was a man of God. Amen. He loved, amen, working for the Master. Thank God that over 30 years ago, I had the blessed privilege to sit under his ministry, and the things that I learned during that time are still active in my life today. Thank God, amen, glory to God, that even 30 years ago, when I had no idea that I would be pastoring today, he was putting things inside of my ministry, my life, that will be active in this ministry today. I thank God for his wisdom, his knowledge. Amen. Whenever he would teach the word of God at Bible class, it was with such authority, such knowledge. Amen. You could not help but absorb something out of it. Amen. You would leave, amen, wanting more. Thank God for the things, amen, that I learned from him that are active in my ministry today. Amen. Glory to God. I learned, amen, many years ago to be compassionate to the members, to always be willing to take a minute to listen to them, to always be willing to pray with them. Amen. Those were things that he taught me. Amen. He also, amen, had a love for the young people. Amen. And he would, no matter what, amen, his time may have been condensed and he had a lot going on, he would always take time to talk to them one-on-one, my children. Amen. When my son called me from LA and I to check on us a few days ago and I told him Bishop Brown had passed, he said, Daddy, I can't even talk. Amen. He was so hurt. But that was the effect that Bishop Brown had, amen, on all those that knew him. So I just want to say today, I thank God for this great man of God. Amen. Whenever I would be in St. Louis and run into him, he always wanted to know how I was doing. He always wanted to know about the ministry. Amen. Glory to God. And so I thank God for him. I thank God, amen, that our path crossed. Amen. Glory to God. Because I truly believe that I'm a better man today for knowing Bishop Lawrence E. Brown. So I say to the family, be strong. Amen. We're here for you. Amen. Glory to God. And know that God has it all under control. And weeping may endure for a night, but certainly joy cometh in the morning. God bless you. We love you. Amen.
Praise the Lord and good evening. I'm Deacon Leonard E. Gardner.
And I'm Sister Sandra Gardner.
And tonight we're here to pay tribute to Bishop Lawrence E. Brown, Sr.
On behalf of the Humphrey family and the Gardner family, we would like to give our deepest sympathy and condolences to the Brown family. We want you to know that we feel your loss and our prayers are with you. We have known Bishop Brown for almost 40 years. We first came to know him during his pastorship at the Pentecostal Church of Jesus Christ. It was during that time that my dad, Deacon Joe Humphrey, and my mother, missionary Aletha Humphrey, were members there, And they worked diligently with the pastor to build the church into the church that it became. Later, Deacon Gardner and I became members, and we were members of the Pentecostal Church of Jesus Christ for over 26 years.
And as members there, we raised our four children and had the opportunity to work in many different capacities. I became a deacon under Pastor Brown's administration and had great times working closely with him. One thing I remember is that Pastor Brown was a very kind man, and he really, really loved people. I just want to say that I thank the Brown family for having given us the opportunity to work closely with him. And we became sort of close with the family themselves. We really love you guys, and we're really glad that you gave us the opportunity to be part of this tribute. We really love you guys. Stay strong in the Lord, and let our prayers continuously be with you. Thank you, and good evening.
When I came to the Pentecostal Church of Jesus Christ, I began to work under Sister Haiti Blissett, who was over the children's ministry. I assisted her with their children's ministry. I worked with missionary Humphreys. She was over the sisterhood. I assisted and helped in that part of the department. But as time went on, I became the president of the children's ministry. I became the president of the sisterhood. I was graced to be the church secretary. And I was even the children's bus driver. I was a church bus driver. So I find myself very active in the church, doing whatever my hands could find to do. And a lot of roles and a lot of people that I helped in different departments. And I just did it graciously, and I did it with loving kindness.
I suppose that even the world itself could not contain the books that should be written. Amen. This was the 21st chapter of St. John and the 25th verse, and it was describing the things of Jesus that he had done. I don't have the time to discuss or even talk about all the things that Bishop Brown was able to accomplish in his short period here on earth. A good man, a just man, an accomplished man, a fair man, one that had compassion. I met Bishop Brown, he was Elder Brown then, about 26 years ago. I was bruised, beaten, and undone. And he was that Samaritan that came around, picked me up, put me on his donkey, and took me to the nearest tavern and paid for me to be there for 1 week. He truly was my neighbor. He wasn't a Levite, he wasn't a priest, but he was Elder Brown. I'll miss him. I give condolences to all of those that he has left behind, all his nieces, nephews, cousins, all the uncles and aunts of all his kids, his grandkids, to the church family as a whole, to the First Lady, Dorothy Brown. He will be truly missed. I can go on and on and on, and truly I can say that if everything could be written down, the things that he was able to accomplish, there wouldn't be room enough to have in the libraries all across the country or around the world. He was a great man, one with an indelible heart. He will be missed. God bless you all. In Jesus' name.
Praise the Lord, family.
Praise the Lord.
How you doing today?
He's all right. Come on, Cooper.
My grandfather, Lawrence Brown.
You can do it.
That name right there is a great man.
Yeah.
I love this man.
Yeah.
It's really deep. You know,
yeah.
My thing is that my grandfather, he really doesn't know, but he kind of does know how much we pay attention to him.
Yeah.
How much we thank him. You know, so all the cousins say that, like, Christmas, we be young coming up, we always got to watch. So, they will say, every Christmas, we be waiting for them watch. I don't know what watch this is. You know, they always know me that day, no matter what it was. That day was something from Grandy.
Yeah.
You know, and I thank him for those moments that he had us, you know, waiting, knowing that he has something for us. Mm-hmm. You know, he always has something to uplift and tell us, you know what I'm saying, to have a bath or whatever. He told me a story one time. He said,
careful, brother.
He said, that was a young man. I was walking down the street. way to the yard sale. He ended up seeing a grandfather clock. He said, well, I like to get it. So he got it. So, since he's on feet, he carried the grandfather clock right home. Walking down the sidewalk, there's a drunk young man coming down the street. Same side. He's carrying the grandfather clock on his shoulder. And the drunk man is walking past him. And somehow, changing positions, the grandfather clock so happened to hit him in the head. Ooh. The man turned around and said, goodness! Can you wear a watch like everybody else?
A man that I can laugh with, joke with, you know, work in the ministry with, you know, just a great man. And I count it an honor to be here and share this poem with him while he can still hear it.
Yes. Yes.
Right. So many times we take life for granted, y'all.
That's right.
We think we got so much time.
Yeah.
And then we get that call. But I'm grateful to God for this opportunity to be here with him, with my aunts and uncles. Give him a hand. They get a wonderful job. So, granddaddy, this is for you.
Go, Tess. Go on, Tess.
These are my eyes, how I see you.
Beautiful. Beautiful, Tess.
Compassionate and gentle. You make my heart sing. You're revered by many. Youthfulness blissfully gleams. At times of distress, you go beyond the call of duty. Your thoughtfulness is a rare beauty. Lending encouraging words to family and friends, it makes life sweeter with each new day begin. Within you, this vessel lies precious commodities, like your keen sense of humor. No one can tell a joke like the way you do, or your sense of style. Always fresh and clean when you step out, you look brand new.
Yeah.
I pray God's continuous grace be bestowed upon your life, that you strive to live pleasing in his sight. For great is your reward. Great is your reward.
Amen.
Yes.
It is an honor to celebrate your arrival to 8 decades.
Isn't that awesome?
We salute you with love and humble accolades. May God give you strength to keep fighting the good fight of faith.
Amen.
Love you always, Tess.
Yes, Tess.
To our family and friends, today we celebrate the life of our cousin, friend, and Bishop, Bishop Lawrence E. Brown, Sr. Our hearts are heavy today as we think about him and as we reflect on the man of God that he was. He was a friend to our family. He was my cousin. And he will be greatly, greatly missed. He was a man of faith. My cousin, Bishop Lawrence E. Brown, was a man who was kind. He was gentle. He was a great counselor. I was called into pastorship. Bishop Lawrence E. Brown was there to help me and give me good counsel. He was a patient man. He was mild-mannered. He was humorous. He would always make me laugh. He was just a wonderful person, wonderful pastor, and a wonderful father, and he will absolutely be greatly missed. I'm praying for my family and praying for the entire Brown family and all relatives that God will give us strength. I'm glad that he's not suffering any longer. I'm glad that he's in a better place, but we are going to need prayer because he was certainly a giant in our family and he's left a wonderful legacy, but we need to pray for one another. So let's pray for each other as we celebrate his life. He'll never be forgotten because he was such a wonderful man. Doretta.
Greetings to the Brown family, to the entire Brown family, the siblings, to Lady Dorothy Brown, and to everyone connected to this family. I offer my condolences. This is a great loss. I've written on Facebook that he was one of the finest gentlemen in Christendom, and that is a fact. My first connection with Bishop Brown was at the Bethesda Temple Church, where he was serving as one of the assistant pastor. And from the day I met Cousin Brown, he has always been the same. He was absolutely supportive, as my husband says, in the ministry. He had a positive attitude. He was pleasant. And no matter where you saw him, he made time for you. It didn't matter that he was a bishop. He made time for you. He made you feel comfortable. He made you felt like you were important. And so he is a great loss, but what an honor that he left us a legacy now that he is with Jesus in paradise. And I know Cousin Brown would not want to come back to this world that we're in today. So let's just pray for each other. Let's be strong in the Lord and allow his legacy now to live in us. May God richly bless you. Amen.
Amen. God bless you.
Hello, I am Bishop Larry J. Baylor, and I serve as the senior pastor of a wonderful local church right here in the North County area of St. Louis, Missouri, called Faith Miracle Temple. I also serve as the presiding bishop of an international reformation called Higher Ground International Ministry. The Lord has blessed us to cover churches all over the United States and around the world. The Lord has been so good to me. What I want to do is share with you some insights on my relationship with Bishop Lawrence Brown Sr. I first met Bishop Brown over 30 years ago through my late great father, Pastor Willie George Baylor. And from the initial time that I met Bishop Brown, first of all, he always had that radiant, magnanimous, drawing smile. I always saw him as being a man that was always full of energy, and he was always very, very happy. And he always encouraged me as a son in the gospel. Even in those early days, he was always very encouraging. And as time went on, I kind of grew up in ministry a little bit. He started treating me like a comrade, but also he would always treat me like a son that he loved. And I thank God for that. I remember the first time Bishop Brown asked me to preach at his church. As a young preacher, I was enamored, because you know how it is when young preachers get to preach at senior pastor churches. Man, it's like heaven on earth. And he loved the message I preached. I think the title of the message was A Bad Day on Good Friday. I preached on Good Friday. It was just awesome. But let me say this to you. I love Bishop Brown. I love him because he treated me so very, very nicely. He treated me with a lot of respect and a lot of honor, because he was a bishop long before I was consecrated. And I just thank God for the humility that he showed in doing that. Let me say this to you. Another thing that I love about Bishop Brown is he was always so kind. He was always kind to me, and I will never forget that. One of the things that I love about Bishop Brown is that just out of the clear blue, during our international conference here at this church, he would just show up and just smile and just be so blessed with what was going on during our international conference. I really thank God for that. I love Bishop Brown's entire family. I know a lot of the family members, we love each other. Bishop Brown, you did a great job being here on planet Earth. And I'll say this, I look forward to seeing you, Bishop, on the other side when we all get together. I look forward to telling you how wonderful you were in helping me become the preacher I am. I love you guys. God bless you. I bid you Godspeed. And remember, until the next time, God wants to take you to higher ground.
To the wonderful Brown family today, I want to express my condolence to you on the loss of a general in God's army. And I want to tell you how much we love him and how much we love Sister Brown and all the Brown children. I am thinking so much of Bishop Brown and the real greatness that he had and exhibited in his life. And I believe that the only real greatness that any of us has is when we stand before the Lord, if the Lord would say, "Well done, thy good and faithful servant." And I believe that with Bishop Brown, that is absolutely and certainly the case, that in all the roles that God assigned to him and all that God assigned for his hand, that he was a faithful and a wise servant. And most of all, I'm so touched and blessed by the legacy that he has left behind in the anointed children that are serving the Lord and are leading lives that are glorifying the Lord. So to this family, I want you to know that you've been in our prayers and our hearts and our minds. We love you, and we're just grateful that this great general of the Lord has went on in glory to that place that's far better. You continue to be in our prayers. God bless you.
Praise the Lord. My name is Lee Brown, and I am one of the many grandchildren of Bishop Lawrence E. Brown, Sr. I got my start in music, playing at his church at a very young age. I played there for about 15 years, and I can remember ever so clearly one of the first songs that I learned how to play. And as I remember it, this is one of his more favorite songs, and it's entitled, "Yes, I Want to See Him."
Give my tribute to my friend, Southern Bishop
Lawrence Brown Sr., which I know him to be a man who is astute student of doctrine, of morals, and church government. He believed in doing things right, and I really respect him for that. One of the other things that I thank God for is that Summit Bishop Brown was a man who was respected because he was a preacher's preacher, and he always gave me opportunities to preach. There was a time when we had a Sunday school workers' conference at his church, and back in the late 80s, early 90s, and I did a workers' conference there. But after the workers' conference, Lady Brown, and at that time it was District Elder Brown, took me back to the back, and they encouraged me from the good work that was done during the Sunday School Workers' Conference. And one of the things that he said, Sister Barry had already said it, but I'm going to say it too, and that is he encouraged me, and she did as well, about if you find yourself with a teacher that is not faithful, get the janitor to teach the bank president. It took me a while to absorb what he was really saying. But over a period of time, I understood, because some of Mr. Brown was a man of wisdom. He didn't say a whole lot, but he was a wise man who knew about preaching. He knew about sound doctrine, and he advocated sound doctrine. And he believed in yielding to leadership. That's another thing that I thank God for about him. But last but not least, I'd like to say this, that some of Bishop Brown was a lover. Yes, he loved good preaching, but he also loved Lady Dorothy as well. And I thank God, amen, for him, and how he exemplified a true apostolic preacher. He always talked about that as well. Apostolic Pentecostal preacher. And I thank God, amen, for his loving encouragement and how he loved his wife. And I'd like to also say, as I said earlier, that Lady Kate Brown was a student of the Word of God. We had a class together there at the district classes, and we were good friends, and I like to say that I'm sure that their lives together truly was an encouragement, because just about every child that they have is a preacher, and they have truly been a blessing to the body of Christ. And I like to say congratulations to all of the family for your father's recommendation, and also your father's legacy. And we pray that Bishop Brown's legacy will never die, and that the family will continue to preach and live the word like he did, in Jesus' name. Thank God.
So my grandfather was my very first teacher that I can remember. He taught me how to strategize, something I use, you know, in my business today. I was about 3 years old, and my grandfather was peacefully eating his breakfast at the dining room table, and I wanted him to share his sausage, but he wasn't in a sharing mood, so he told me no. And so I kept asking him, he told me no, and so I walked away and I cried, and I came back and I asked him again, and I was three, and so it's interesting that my mom was operating this way, but I came back and I asked him again, and he was just like, no, little baby, where's your mom? You know, go get some sausage from her. So I grabbed the sausage off of his plate, and I began to run. And Granddaddy chased me down and he took his sausage back. And I was devastated. You know, I was really hungry. He was the only person that was woke and I wanted a sausage. So I sat in the corner, I cried and I thought for a minute. I didn't give up and I came up with a plan. So I went back and I asked him politely, can I have a sausage? He said no. So I took the sausage, I ran, and this time I ate the sausage while I was running. So when he caught me, he could not get the sausage back. So he taught me how to strategize. My grandfather taught me how to think at a very young age, and I still use that today in my life. When I look at my grandfather, he's a man. I believe that he's a faith-filled man. I was very young. I don't think I was even born when he started his church, Pentecostal Church of Jesus Christ. But to launch out like that and start something new with a large family, that takes faith. And so, you know, that's what he instilled in me as a young lady, to have faith, to go after the things that I desire to have in my life, to keep moving forward, even though opposition comes. You know, challenges, we face them all the time. You know, that was one thing that I adopted from my grandfather. And then just growing up in the home with him, my grandfather was always loving and giving. He was more like a father as opposed to a grandfather. You know, some of my aunts, we were kind of close in age, but we grew up kind of like siblings a little bit, you know. But my grandfather would pay me to clean up the house we lived in. When anniversary time came, we were always excited. My cousins and I, we loved it because Granddaddy would always take the whole family out and we would just be able to eat whatever we wanted. He didn't care. He just, you could see the joy on his face of seeing his family happy, you know. So I'm grateful to him for being who he is as a man, you know. He came home, we knew he was, and even as I got older in life, I could go, and I would go talk to my grandfather sometimes, sit on his porch, and he'll talk to me about some of the things that I particularly found challenging in life. He gave me wisdom, he prayed with me, he talked with me like a man, you know, like a man would talk to a woman, a father would talk to a daughter, and I really appreciated that about him. And even to this day, you know, we were sitting in church yesterday, and he was moved to tears to see his children. My aunt was up speaking, and I turned and I looked at him and I said, wow, look, this is fruit of your labor. I said, aren't you proud? And he just teared up a little bit more. He said, yeah, I'm very proud. You know, he was a trailblazer in his own way. I respect and I honor my grandfather for just being a really great guy. Any home that I've ever had, he's always came over, broke bread with me. He was never too busy. He complimented me on my food. He always tells me I'm beautiful. Girls need that, you know? And so to get that from your grandfather, that means a lot. So I'm just grateful to have him in my life.
Hello, everybody. My name is Stephanie. I am Lawrence's oldest granddaughter. My mother is Mary, who is the third born child to Lawrence and Kate Brown. To the left of me is my husband, Charles, my son, Jordan. In front of me is my grandson, Carter, and this is my daughter, Faith. We are here to pay tribute to my grandfather, Lawrence Brown. We love him very much. As a young child, my grandfather used to take me to church with him. It was just him and I really cherish those moments. You're definitely going to miss Granddaddy.
My name is Charles. I really just want to just express how kind Grandpa Brown was. He was just a kind man. He was very kind to me. I really appreciate him, and I appreciate he gave lineage to Black and Mary, my beautiful wife.
And Granddaddy was Granddaddy. He always knew what to say. He always was there when you needed him. I always heard good things about him. Never nothing bad. A few times I ran into a few people
that have known Granddaddy, Grandmama, and everybody throughout the ministry, let me say. So let me just say that his reputation proceeds.
Granddaddy was a good man. He was my only granddaddy that I really knew, that I really grew up around, that I really got a chance to have a relationship with, and that relationship was strong and it was loving and caring. And I want to just say I love you, Granddaddy, and I appreciate the time that we had together.
Carter, you gonna say something to Granddaddy?
Love you, Granddaddy.
All right. All right. So from our family, we're gonna miss you, Granddaddy. We love you very much.
Yes.
Until later, we'll see you in heaven. Peace.
What do you say? What do you say? Oh man, first words come to my mind is, wow. You know, I can't believe that my grandfather is transcended. My grandfather was, to me, a special person. I love him dearly. It seemed like just yesterday we was all just kind of running up and down the street on Edison Street. I remember my cousins playing double dutch and having little sing-a-thons and stuff like that. And it was really something. It was really something. And my grandfather was always either going to work or coming from work. And I think about Black history when I think about people like my grandfather, and I think to myself, wow, what it must have been like for him to grow up in that era, you know, where people were still being wrongfully accused of things. And he was a dark-skinned Black male who, in a time where that was very dangerous, he was able to see himself through it, you know. So I like to think of him as a shrewd person, you know. I'm going to miss his laughter. I'm going to miss his jokes. I'm going to miss the way he could put on a suit, you know. And I believe he won, you know, meaning people that come from where he came from in that era, you know, just not a lot of education and things like that, but you're still able to become assistant pastor and then grow up to be a pastor. You were able to marry two beautiful women, father eight children, I believe, and I think it was like 100 and something grandchildren. And he helped so many people, you know, and I just want to say thank you to you, man. And so if I feel a little bit of a shiver, or if I feel a rap at my window or my door, I'm going to be thinking that that's probably him coming by to say hi.
Family, greetings and salutations. This is the baby of the Fabulous Six, the oldest crew of Kate and Lawrence Brown Sr. I just want to give my little tribute to my grandfather. I have several fond memories of my grandfather. You know, he was the epitome of what a man should be to his family. You know, taking care of the family, taking care of the grandkids, working two jobs full time, you know, and then having a full time church, Pentecostal Church of Jesus Christ. He reared us up in the way of God. If it hadn't been for my grandfather, you know, we wouldn't have known God, you know, outside of him and my grandmother, Lady Kate Brown. I just have a few fond memories of my grandfather, you know. My grandfather was always a comedian, first of all. He always made you laugh. You know, he put us in the mindset of Bill Cosby, you know, with the sweaters and the slew foot, you know, and, you know, hey, how you doing? You know, this, that, another, whatever. You know, my grandfather was always a jolly guy, you know what I mean? And he told me one time, you know, if for every A you get $7. For every B you get $6. I worked my butt off to get those dollars, and I made $42 to get a pair of British Knights back in like 1989. You know, he was just a gracious guy. I also remember as being a kid, my grandfather, every Sunday, he would get a Sunday paper. He would give us a comb and he would say, scratch my back. So we would scratch his back. He would like, harder, harder, harder. And we would scratch our grandfather's back. You know, he just loved to feel his back scratch, and he would reward us with the funny papers. So we got the funny papers and we got to watch the colorful weather report with him. You know what I mean? And then, you know, okay, time to go to bed. Okay. And another fun memory I had of him is that, you know, whenever I needed to ride to church with him, he would always come and pick me up. It doesn't matter. If church started at 10:30 and I called him at 9:30, he would be there at 9:50. That means I had to hurry up and get dressed. But I'm gonna always cherish the memories that I have with my grandfather. He was a great guy. Great guy. Loved his children, loved his grandchildren, you know. And I'm gonna miss him, you know. So until we meet again, Papa, kiss grandmama for me. And I'll see you later. All right.
In loving memory of Lawrence E. Brown Sr., we are the children of his youngest son, Philip Brown, which is our dad, what makes us his twin granddaughters. The only ones. The only twin granddaughters that he has.
Yes.
Just as comes right from his son, from his son's loins. We came out of that. We branched from that tree. And we love you, Granddaddy. And this is Felicia and Fiona Brown. And we love you, Granddaddy, for being a great man of God, a great leader in our lives, as well as amongst your daily life. We love you and thank you.
Hi, Granddaddy. This is Michaela. I just want to say that I love you. You know, I'm grateful that you came to my graduation. I'll always appreciate that.
It's time to remember my grandfather, a very inspirational man, a sharp-dressed man, a man of faith, a family man, a man that did what he had to do for his children, took care of his responsibilities, a great example on how to be a man in this world. I just appreciate his life. He was around every single day of my life until the day that he passed, and I just love and appreciate what he meant to me in this world. I'm so grateful to God for his life, for what he did, for what he accomplished, for everybody he influenced. I'm grateful for the legacy he leaves behind, even down to my namesake, Lawrence Brown. I'm just so grateful to have known him, and it's even better to have been related to him. So I'm just grateful to God for the life of my grandfather.
Christ Temple Church. District Elder James E. Coates is the pastor, and First Lady Betty D. Coates is the First Lady. It gives me such an honor and a privilege to come before you to just talk about the life and legacy of Suffragan Bishop Lawrence E. Brown Sr. You know, I only have a couple of minutes, so I felt that it was best for me to write a couple of notes so I can stay within that time frame. And Bishop Brown served as the Suffragan Bishop of the Second Jurisdiction Churches of the Midwestern District Council, Pentecostal Assemblies of the World, where Bishop Larry O. Jones is the diocesan. And I've known and I've worked with Bishop Brown down through the years in the Second Jurisdiction. I would like to take this time to honor the memory of Mother Kate Brown also for her contributions. And I honor the First Lady Evangelist Dorothy Brown for her love and support of Bishop. I served Bishop as the secretary of the Second Jurisdiction. And I would like for you to know I serve at his pleasure and at his direction regarding the support services and publicizing of the jurisdictional services. I want you to know that Bishop Brown was an easy person to work for. He was always upbeat, he had a happy spirit, and he wanted the best for the Second Jurisdiction and its pastors and its members. He believed in starting services on time. And Bishop had the thought of this: start the service at 4 p.m., be out by 6 p.m. He had such a love for the churches and the pastors and the members, because his thought was they've been in church all day at their service. They've been in Sunday school. They've been in morning worship. And now they're in another 4 o'clock service. So I just like to say that he had a love for the people. He also ensured not only speaking opportunities for the pastors, but also the first ladies and others. He gave them an opportunity to stand before the people of God. He loved the body of Christ, and he loved faithfulness. I love Bishop Sayings, and he talks about a faithful worker. And he said, let the faithful janitor teach the bank president. That was his emphasis on faithfulness. He was a strong but compassionate leader. And the members of the Second Jurisdiction loved Suffragan Bishop Brown. And I would often hear them say, the bishop is here, the bishop is here. It was such a joy just to see him enter the building. He demonstrated much love, kindness, consideration, and a holy life. And Bishop Lawrence E. Brown is a mighty leader. He was a mighty leader who has left an imprint on the lives of many. So as the secretary of the Second Jurisdiction, I would like to say to his family, I would like to say to First Lady Dorothy Brown, to the church family of Pentecostal Church of Jesus Christ, to the Second Jurisdiction, I got much joy in serving this giant of a man of God. May God bless you, may God strengthen you, and may his precious memories be with you in Jesus' name. May God bless you real good.
I could say that I have known Bishop Brown all of my life, and serving in the council, serving at Bethesda Temple Church. I came from the Livingstone Church of God under Bishop P.L. Scott and Bishop Alfonso Scott, and then moved to Bethesda Temple in December of 1993. Within that time, I served the Midwestern District Council. I would be there serving. One thing that Bishop Johnson always told us is to know those that labor amongst you, to know those that have served amongst you, labor amongst you. And one thing I can say, that as long as I have known Bishop Brown, that he has always been a servant. He has always served the people of God. He's been a nice man, a sound man, a sturdy man, very comical, but he is about God's business. He has his own personality. I know that at one point that I had, even in ministry, had some challenges, that he was there, he and his wife was there to have a listening ear, would try to encourage me to hold on, just to let things ease itself out. And sometimes I would give him an earful, and he would just listen, he'll give that, oh, but he would always give us a good sense of counsel. And so he and his wives have been nothing but kind, nothing but sweet, and nothing but fair to me, and encouraging in this walk in ministry.
My name is Lawrence Brown. I am the bishop over the third jurisdiction of the Midwest District of the Pentecost Center of the World. I have been pastoring the Church of Jesus Christ for 35 years. I have been preaching for 65 years. I was assistant pastor, but there's a temple for 20 years. And I'm enjoying myself as a minister of the gospel, and I'm enjoying myself as a child of God. And I'm just glad to be here in this section of recording. My role in the Midwest District Council is a very precious role. First of all, I have been a member of the Midwest District Council for 65 years. And I've been the Suffragan Bishop for 15 years. And I have walked with God, and I have been over 15 churches during that time as Suffragan Bishop. Even my good friend who was very close to us, Pastor Victoria Brown, she was in my jurisdiction for 10 years, after which she was moved over to another jurisdiction. And also Bishop Griffin was a member of our jurisdiction for 12 years. And I think that my impact on those people were very strong, because they always told me that the things I told them stuck. And I had somebody say to me at the church I was at yesterday, they said, there's a sermon you preached some years ago. And I still remember that sermon, A Missionary Out of Hell. And those things make you feel good when people tell you that the things you said to them stick with you. But my greatest challenge, is to walk with God in the midst of sickness. And God did deliver me all out of the law.
Greetings to each of you today. It is a great privilege to be coming to you today through this memorial virtual tribute on behalf of our suffragan bishop, Lawrence Brown Sr. I view the transition of Bishop Brown with mixed emotions. But yet I am encouraged through the word of God, the Apostle Paul, who told us and comforted us with these words, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And I believe it was the Philippian church that he said, it is needful that I come to you. But he said, I have a desire to be with Christ, which is far better. I shall always remember our suffragan bishop, Lawrence E. Brown. I shall always remember him as a good man and a good servant in the kingdom of God. Not only was he a good servant, but in my own opinion, and as I was able to relate to Bishop Brown was a resourceful man in God's kingdom. He was a man with a lot of wealth and knowledge and spiritual intuition given to him by God. Bishop Brown never blew a trumpet for himself. He never paved a path for himself, but he was a mighty stalwart giant in Christendom. Not only that, but Bishop Brown, to me, I shall remember him as an inspirational servant. When I got the move of God to start a ministry, I reached out to Bishop Brown. And it took a lot of courage, it took a lot of resilience, and it took a lot of fortitude. But Bishop Brown put his arms around me. Bishop Brown counseled me. He became a pastor to a pastor. And I'll never forget the many good times he, his lovely wife, Sister Dorothy Brown, and my wife, we shared in fellowship together. And not only that, but Bishop Brown was instrumental in me being where I am right now in the kingdom of God. And I love Bishop Brown, and I'll always remember him. He married me and my wife a few years ago. And I say to Sister Dorothy Brown and to all of the Brown family and the entire congregation of the Pentecostal Church of Jesus Christ of the Apostolic Faith and the McCoy family, and I'd even be remiss to not mention the McMullins, but to each of you, however you are bonded in relation to our precious suffragan bishop, of whom we were blessed to serve under his jurisdiction in the second jurisdiction of the Midwestern District Council. We want you to know the word of God comfort us and lets us know that having all comfort and grace, he is able to comfort us through times like these. May God bless you. We're praying for you, and we are at your beckoning call. I say to my friend, my pastor, my leader, my mentor, rest in Jesus, and I'll see you in the morning.
Praise the Lord, everyone. God bless you. And we do honor our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the head of our lives. And we give honor to all of the family and your great loss as your father, Bishop Lawrence Brown. We honor a man, his home going on this day, and we are certainly happy that God is in control. We have much going on now, and we are grieved at your loss. And I was just wanting to say that he certainly would rather be missed in our second jurisdiction. I'm knowing a great deal from Amen, Bishop Brown. He's a very knowledgeable man. And I would just like to, if I'm in order, to read a scripture here. It's in 2 Timothy 4:7-8 verse there. And I'm trying to get the 3 minutes in and being obedient. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Yes. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearance. God bless you, and I'm praying very much for you, and also, Dorothy, we are praying for you in your loss, and my wife is going to hell.
I just want to say that, Dorothy, we've been many places together with Bishop, conventions and going out of town, eating breakfast at Denny's and going other places. And just want to let you know that we're praying for you. Also, our First Lady, President Crystal Swanigan, we're praying for her. Brother District Elder Ron Stevens, we're praying for you. And we're praying for the McCoy, my best friend, Sister Dr. McCoy, and all the family, but mainly we've been with the family all our life, all our marriage.
Yes,
we want to let you know that we love you all. We got you in our prayers, and if I forgot to call your name, you're in it too, especially to Bishop Lawrence Brown Jr. and his wife and Philip. We love you all. If you need us, give us a call or whatever you need. We still by your side. God bless you all.
Amen.
Amen.
Well, as well deserving as the degree of preaching the apostolic doctrine. Amen. One of the forefathers.
Yes.
Amen. Still around preaching and teaching.
Yes.
Amen. We thank you, Dr. Brown. Seeing that the candidate has been certified, qualified, has been fit and worthy of this degree, we the people of God, of the Apostolic Faith Church community, through this Apostolic Faith Organization, the International Association of Apostolic Apologists, Institute of Theology, confer and bestow on this candidate, all to the responsibilities of the Doctrine of Apostolic Faith Theology and Christian Service. We're now preparing for the hoodie.
Go ahead, Bishop.
That's all right. Go ahead, Papa. The hoodie has now been placed around you. And attaining this degree, and we place that on you now.
Excellent.
Also, we place the Luna. This is all right for crap, you know. This is where we get out of hand. We now place the Luna medallion on you. That exhibits your degree. Dr. Brown.
You may put this medallion on you now. It has your name on the back. It has your degree that you received on the back of it. And we want you to wear it for pride, just like Dr. Master Cole does. And let everybody know that you have received your degree from the International Association of Apostolic Apologists, and that the entire Apostolic Faith community has claimed you as a doctor of theology.
Amen. I want to give you a hand to God. Praise God.
My advice to the church, first of all, is to walk with God with all your heart and lean not to your own understanding. The church now is going through some trying times, and I'll say along with others, the word of God has not changed, but the methods in the church have. And you do have to change with the methods, but you never have to change the word of God. For the Bible says God's word is the same today. He's same today, yesterday, and forever. So my advice to the church is to dig deeper into his word and let nothing turn you around. Don't let low membership make you go. Don't preach false gospel so that you can get a bunch of members. But walk with God with all your heart and let the word of God be the thing that keeps you going. And I believe if you do that, the church will come up from where it's at. You've got people nowadays who they will do anything to get members. But that's not the thing you want. You'd rather have a few members that are saved than thousands of them that are not. And you want to say when the day of judgment comes, the Lord will say, you're well done, thy goodness person says, you've been faithful with that which is least, I'll make you ruler over that which is many. So I say to the church, do all you know that is right. And God will bless you and bless whatever you put your hands to in the name of the Lord. I would like to see the church move up in an area where they will love one another the more. They would strive not to have dissension among each other, and that you will love those even if they don't love you. Pray for them that despitefully use you. Help those that don't help you. Give good advice to everybody, and don't allow the devil to cause you to fight against your brother and sister in the house of the Lord. And also be obedient as best you can to the word of God. I would say to a young minister who is coming along and expect to be a pastor that he is to never forget his family, your family, the church, and then God. And not only that, you are to always reverence God and always treat your wife as your queen. Never mistreat her, never do her wrong, but always try to use the Bible as your guideline as to how you treat your wife. And the Bible will direct you in such a way that you will have a wonderful marriage because you obey the word of God. And so that is one of the things that has kept me going. A good wife, person that loves the Lord along with her husband, and children that were obedient to the word of the Lord. And as a father, an example to my sons to be great lovers of their wives. And I can attest to that, that they are two brothers that know how to love their wives. My wife said to me the reason that they love their wife the way that they do is because you love your wife the way you should have done. And I think that's a big part of my marriage life in ministry.
But when you get my age, you're paying to be anyway. And I'm happy to be here today, and I thank the Lord for each one of you that is here today, all of my relatives, my colleagues in the gospel, district elders, the pastors, the bishops, subdivision bishops, my sisters, my children, my extended family. And for everybody who is here, I am just a happy man today.
You know what I'm here today? God is looking for a pain out of the poor man, pain out of the rich man, pain out of the sick man, pain out of the well man, pain out of the man is up, pain out of the man is down. That's something I'm praising the Lord. That God will lose the band. That's something I'm praising the Lord. That God will open the door. That's something I'm praising the Lord. Pray to God.
Everywhere
you
worship. Shall I seek him? And the word says, seek him until he bring righteousness over the church of the living God. So today, we want to be more caught up in walking with God and hold fast to those things that we've heard. The Bible says, hold on to those things you heard. How much you let them slip? We've got to find a way to hold on to the things that God has told us in past years. And what God has said to us, the Bible says, Jesus is the same today, yesterday, and forevermore. So if he was called for holiness and righteousness and evangelizing,
Lord,